I'm Corporal Scott Pesca. Join Petty Officer Christina Brockman and me on Navy Marine Corps News. This week, Marines and sailors move out to avoid Hurricane Floyd, then return to assist flood victims in the Carolinas and Virginia. Navy and civilian law enforcement and anti-terrorism organizations converge on a Navy barracks building in Washington, D.C. for some very realistic training. And the Indian Wells Golf Course in Southern California hosts military golf teams in the 1999 Desert Strike Golf Tournament. These stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, Marines and sailors move out to avoid Hurricane Floyd, then return to assist flood victims in the Carolinas and Virginia. Navy and civilian law enforcement and anti-terrorism organizations converge on a Navy barracks in Washington, D.C. for some very realistic training. And the Indian Wells Golf Course in Southern California hosts military golf teams in the 1999 Desert Strike Golf Tournament. These stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News.
Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Corporal Scott Pesca.
And I'm Petty Officer Christina Brockman.
Here on the East Coast, there is one story that recently dominated the headlines, Hurricane Floyd.
And with bases like naval stations Mayport and Norfolk and a large concentration of Marines in the Carolinas, the Navy Marine Corps team had to keep a close eye on Floyd. Chief Tom Cardell has more.
Preparations for the storm started early, with Navy ships getting underway to avoid potential damage. The ships are much safer at sea than they would be pierside, where the combination of winds, high seas, and the piers themselves could cause damage and injuries. And while they were underway, sailors monitored the weather affecting their family members back home, with a special feed of local weather and news provided over the direct-to-sailor satellite network.
Informed about Hurricane Floyd.
Hurricane Floyd is history, but he sure did make his mark on Hampton Roads.
Once ships get underway, their mission is simple: steer clear of the storm. But USS John F. Kennedy steered itself back into the storm to perform a daring rescue of tugboat sailors who were forced to abandon ship. The Navy's rescue efforts didn't end once the storm passed by. Sailors from Helicopter Combat Support Squadrons 2 and 6 teamed up to rescue hundreds of North Carolina residents from flooded areas in the days after the hurricane.
In the last 7 hours, we rescued 60 people to higher ground. Some were in the water, some were on dry land. It's another day of the office. That's a great feeling. The first one this morning was a couple stranded in a car in about 4 foot of water. She had about a 10 or 11 month old baby, which is about the age of my son at home. That was a great feeling.
These sailors rescued nearly 800 residents in four counties and provided food, drinking water, and medical supplies to the stricken area. Chief Tom Cridell, Navy Marine Corps News.
You know, Chief Cardell mentioned USS John F. Kennedy in his report and how it sailed right into Hurricane Floyd for a daring rescue effort.
The odds were stacked against the JFK as they went to find crew members of a sinking tugboat.
Floyd's gusting winds and high seas, coupled with the fact the tugboat crew had abandoned the boat and were about 300 miles off the Florida coast, gave the JFK little hope for success.
NBC's Jim Mikleshevsky has the heroic rescue efforts in this week's Focus on the Fleet.
At the height of Hurricane Floyd, the aircraft carrier John F. Kennedy cruising away from the storm, out of harm's way, when it gets the distress call. A commercial tugboat, the Gulf Majesty, caught near the eye of the storm, about 300 miles off the Florida coast. The tug sinking and its eight-man crew abandoning ship into the raging seas. The Kennedy turns around and heads back into the hurricane to rescue the crew, waves crashing over its deck, six stories high.
Almost immediately upon turning, we had waves that came up and knocked some of our life rafts that we store alongside the ship at flight deck level into the sea.
In a satellite interview from the carrier today, Captain Mike Miller said no other rescue ship was even close.
It was up to us, or else those people were, quite likely going to perish.
With 100 mile per hour winds and giant seas, the crew members from the sinking tug fight for their lives.
Survival was on the mind. That's all I was thinking about.
Three crew members never make it into the life raft. Wearing life vests and clinging to a broomstick, they're pounded by the waves.
And you get air when you can. You got waves breaking over the top of you all the time and coming from different sides.
But the Kennedy and its helicopters are still 4 hours away. Once in the air, chopper pilot Joe D'Angelo still has doubts.
We thought there's no way we're going to find them out there. And it was just luck, you know, thank God.
When the choppers spot the three in the water, rescue diver Shad Hernandez is lowered by cable into a 30-foot trough. This would be his first rescue.
It was just a look of amazement on their faces. They were like, thank you, it's good to see you. You know, they were screaming, and I had so much adrenaline, I just yelled at one of them to come with me.
I ain't never wanted to see somebody so bad in my life.
The choppers return the three to the Kennedy, but then go back into the storm again to rescue five more in the life raft.
It was really a miracle that they even found us in that short span. It was definitely God sent.
God sent and mission accomplished.
All I know is I owe my life and that for these fellows and that over here on the JFK.
Jim Mikleshevsky, NBC News, the Pentagon.
Our thanks again to NBC News and Jim Mikleshevsky for that story.
I can't get over that. Three men clinging to a broom in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, and the JFK was able to find them. That's amazing.
I agree. It's a good thing the JFK was so close and able to help.
The USS Theodore Roosevelt Battle Group has returned home after a successful deployment.
As the battle group began its journey home, they got a special at-sea visit by top Navy leaders. Petty Officer Chris Avant has the story.
Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Jay Johnson congratulated sailors on a job well done during recent operations while the Roosevelt Battle Group was on deployment.
It gave me an opportunity as TR steams through the Med toward home to thank them for the incredible deployment that they've had, both here in the Mediterranean, in the Adriatic with the operations in Kosovo, and in the Arabian Gulf with Operation Southern Watch. It's been a tremendously important deployment, executed beautifully, and I'm tremendously proud, and I wanted to convey that to these wonderful men and women.
Admiral Johnson also talked about pay issues while on board the TR, USS Ramage, and the Leyte Gulf.
That on January 1st of 2000, you're going to get a 4.8% pay raise. But in addition to that, on July 1st of 2000, we're going to put into place something called pay table reform, which essentially is a matrix spread across all E1 to O10, okay, so that there are some people, mid-grade enlisted particularly, and mid-grade officers, who are going to get in excess of that 4.8% pay raise.
The CNO also had good news for sailors who joined the Navy after August 1986.
All of you are going to have the option of stepping out of the redux retirement business, the 40% retirement. And you have the option of going to what everybody else has got that joined after 1980, what's called the high three retirement, and you can make that choice. Or you have the choice of taking $30,000 at the 15-year point in your career, committing to another 5 years of service, and then staying with redux. You have the choice.
In addition, Admiral Johnson took the time to talk with some sailors and even stopped for a few photo opportunities.
People don't really thank us for our job, and for him to come out here and personally thank us is a great thing for morale and for everybody on the ship.
It's nice to know that the higher-ups were listening and that they actually care.
I'm Petty Officer Chris Avant, Navy Marine Corps News.
The TR Battle Group had some major accomplishments, like giving out $3.1 million in reenlistment bonuses.
That is amazing. Well, for those of you who take medications on a regular basis, like for high blood pressure, you may want to check this out.
The Department of Defense has a mail-order pharmacy, and it's available for active duty service members, their families, and retirees.
If you'd like to find out more, the phone number is 1-800-903-4680.
It's time for a break. Stay tuned, though. The MCPON Minute is coming right up.
This week, MCPON Herdt discusses the interdeployment training cycle reductions.
Stay right there.
Hello, shipmates. MCPON Herdt here. One of the most innovative changes being launched to improve your quality of life is the restructuring of the interdeployment training cycle, or IDTC. A year ago, the CNO directed all hands to identify evolutions and inspections that could be streamlined or even eliminated to minimize sailors' workload between deployments. Shipboard sailors should be reaping the benefits as I speak. We were hearing far too many sailors saying they couldn't wait to get to sea so they could get a break. That's not the way to treat sailors when in port. We're working to eliminate that, and your ideas are key in this effort. Keep them coming. I promise you that your quality of life is a top priority. Until the next time, I'll see you about the fleet.
Give you a ride you'll never forget.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News.
Thanks for sticking with us.
The Battenberg Cup is given every year to the ship's crew that takes top honors in the most personnel programs like sailor retention and advancement rate. And once again, the sailors aboard USS Barry have made their mark as the best in the Atlantic.
From January 1st to December 31st in 1998, USS Barry earned the title of being the best ship in the Atlantic Fleet based on the crew's personal achievements.
It's the culmination of all the work that we've put in on a day-to-day basis, and sometimes a night-to-night basis.
1998 marks the third year USS Barry received the Battenberg Cup Award in the last 5 years. And with a retention rate of 78% for enlisted and 100% for officers, it's very apparent that USS Barry is going to be tough to beat next year also.
The ship as a whole, I mean, from the ranks of E1 through O5, we come together to complete a common task, a common goal. We pull together and across the board, and from operations to ship's morale, to whatever it takes in order to accomplish the mission.
Another one of the achievements that made USS Barry the best was a passing rate of 99.9% on advancement exams and a 100% officer surface warfare qualification.
All their hard work really paid off.
Sure did. Now they have proof that their crew was the best.
16 law enforcement and anti-terrorism organizations converged on a Navy barracks in Washington, D.C. for some very realistic training during Exercise Crystal Breakers 99.
Petty Officer Nico Melendez has the story.
The Naval Criminal Investigative Service organized the training to teach the organizations how to work well together and stay prepared.
Crystal Breakers is an exercise that tests our multi-service and multi-agency response to a chemical, biological, terrorist-type situation in this urban environment that we have in Washington.
The target this day was a room on the second floor of a barracks building. The scenario: three terrorists holding sailors and civilians hostage. The problem: how to free the hostages from obvious danger.
There's no need to get all excited. Everything is okay. We're not playing any tricks.
The negotiators denied the terrorists' demand for a face-to-face meeting with Secretary of the Navy Richard Danzig, but did shut off the building's fire alarm and provided food and an American flag.
Get on your hands and knees!
But in the end, the negotiations failed, and it was time to call in the SWAT team to storm the building. The terrorists were ready for them and set a few traps. Teamwork also played a vital role in apprehending the subjects. This exercise also tested the team's ability to deal with the risk of chemical and biological contamination. Local hospitals were also called upon to treat simulated injuries. The training prepared law enforcement personnel for possible threats, but today also prepared some sailors.
It was kind of neat, but scary at the same time, because going through somewhat an actual thing, knowing that in actuality, if it really did happen, it'd be a lot worse than what we had gone through.
Petty Officer Nico Melendez, Navy Marine Corps News.
Exercises like Crystal Breakers are planned for other military and federal installations around the world.
And speaking of training, one way to be prepared for disaster is to know what to do when one happens.
Navy corpsmen and other medical personnel of the U.S. military join medics of other nations to practice responding to medical emergencies in the field.
Petty Officer Terry Redden of Navier Magazine has the story.
MedCure 99, conducted by U.S. Naval Forces Europe, was a joint and combined training and medical exercise conducted to provide an interchange of medical information and techniques with military and civilian medical personnel from Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia.
The most aim of this exercise was to train our staff, it means the Latvian, Lithuanian, and Estonian, to the basics of international operations procedures, the Geneva Convention, also they give a good example of the international collaboration between the American medics and ours.
This gives us a chance to learn from each other, get to know each other, see how we each work, what we expect of each other, and to be fully prepared in any future type of peace support type operations that might come up.
About 100 American military members and civilians joined another 100 doctors and medical specialists from the Baltic countries in the exercise. U.S. participants included Navy doctors, nurses, and corpsmen from U.S. and European commands, U.S. Air Force, and U.S. Army Europe. Also taking part were disaster management and humanitarian assistance specialists, as well as civilian medical personnel.
We've all got to be able to work as a team. If we go to a crisis or some sort of catastrophe, if we can't work together with other people, it's not going to get accomplished. And this is a way to do it. I mean, they know how our triage is, and we're all on the same sheet of music, and we're working together.
MedCure was conducted in two phases. The first was classroom training, which covered emergency medical procedures, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, and preventive medicine. The second phase was the practical application of the classroom lessons, culminating with a simulated airplane crash. The drill included medical problems common to disasters, such as triage, field anesthesia, and shock. Exercises such as MedCure 99 allow nations to practice these skills before they are needed. They promote a valuable familiarity with the operating environment of the Baltic region. After all, a crisis is not the time to learn how to work with another nation.
Everything in today's modern Navy and Marine Corps centers around high-tech, sophisticated vehicles and computers.
But sometimes even that's not good enough, and the only way to get the job done is going back to basics.
Sergeant Amy Forsyth has more.
There's no doubt that every Marine has felt like somebody's workhorse at one time or another, but for Marines with 1st Battalion, 7th Marine Regiment, they recently got a break.
When they told me I was going to be a mule packer, I figured they were talking about me packing more stuff, but I didn't know they actually had animals, so it was a pleasant surprise.
Not only were they surprised to find out they weren't going to carry their weapons to the field, but that the Marine Corps' very own mules were going to carry them.
Yeah, you can get mules probably more places than you can get like a Hummer, but I'd rather put my 50 cal on a mule than have it on my shoulders.
6 mules and 2 horses are year-round residents at the Marine Corps' only pack station. Infantry battalions, weapons platoons in particular, rely on mule packing training to show how animals can be used when mechanized vehicles are not available.
You know, for like a one-day movement, a fairly short movement, like we're going on today, 6, 7, 8 miles, you know, you could put up to probably 300 pounds on them. You know, and it's not so much as the number of packs they can carry, but it's how much packs weigh and how much whatever you're putting on there weighs. Usually we try to put, what we teach these guys is like a quarter of their estimated weight.
Mules are a crossbreed of horse and donkey and have proved to be the ideal animal to carry gear, food, and water. Reporting for Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Sergeant Amy Forsyth.
It is kind of surprising to learn that the Marine Corps still uses mules as the best method of transporting equipment over rough terrain.
Yes, it is, and you could also tell the Marines take great care of the mules.
Mm-hmm. Well, beginning October 1st, TRICARE will extend its family member dental plan to all overseas locations.
TRICARE says the plan is important to families at remote locations whose local military dental facility can't handle extensive procedures like crowns, bridges, and dentures.
Family members already enrolled in the TRICARE Family Member Dental Plan will not have to re-enroll to participate in the plan overseas.
To find out more about the program, visit this website, www.uccI.com, or call 717-957-5017.
Right now, we have to take a small break, but you'll want to stay with us.
When we come back, we're going to check out how sailors battled it out in the desert to see who's number one.
Don't go away.
people know what the SEAL does. I kind of like the idea of that.
So you need to get in and, you know, do your job and get out of there not being seen.
No SEAL gets left behind. Everybody goes home.
You have to be able to persevere and get the job done no matter what. I will not fail.
The kind of people we require, someone who can go hard or go home.
I knew what I came in the Navy to do. I specifically came in to become a Navy SEAL.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News.
USS Eisenhower and USS San Jacinto sailors, who also just happen to be race car fans, got a cool opportunity recently.
It all started when NASCAR Craftsman truck racers visited the ships.
And to thank the sailors, the racers invited the crew members to join their team for a day.
Petty Officer Kathy Thomas from our Norfolk detachment has that story.
Six sailors from USS Eisenhower and USS San Jacinto traded their Navy ball caps for NASCAR ball caps at a day at the races. But these sailors weren't just spectators at the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race. They served as honorary crew members.
That's outstanding. I mean, the treatment that we're getting here is just the top of the line. This is totally too much.
The crew exchange was NASCAR's way of thanking the two ships' crews for hosting six of the race truck drivers in July. The drivers toured the San Jack Inn port and flew out to the Ike for 2 days of shipboard life.
Well, I mean, you know, you guys took care of us, and it was quite the trip that we went on and had quite an adventure. So to come back and have you guys see our side of the world is something that we thought we should do.
We got a chance to see what all they do out there, and it's something spectacular. So it's a good thing that they get to come and visit with us.
When the sailors arrived at the racetrack, they were paired off with six different drivers. They spent the rest of the day lending a helping hand in the garage and asking lots of questions.
My goal is to become a Winston Cup mechanic or a truck mechanic, one of the two. And when I heard about this, I knew it was an opportunity of a lifetime for me.
Once the race started, the crew chiefs wasted no time putting them to work. Watching the real pit crews change four tires, tighten bolts, and fill gas tanks was a great lesson in teamwork for these sailors.
Well, I think it's more important here because these mechanics are reading each other's minds. And it's just, things are just coming natural for them.
While each sailor rooted for his own team during the 200-mile race, they all helped Greg Biffle celebrate in the winner's circle. From Richmond International Raceway, I'm Petty Officer Kathy Thomas, Navy Marine Corps News.
Sailors and Marines recently took part in a special operation called Desert Strike.
It's probably not what you think, but any way you slice it, the mission was successful.
Petty Officer Chris Robinson has a story that is par for the course.
120 players, 31 commands, one golf course. Indian Wells recently played host to the 1999 Desert Strike Invitational Championship Golf Tournament, which involved the best military golf teams in Southern California, all gunning to be number one.
That's great. We played last year, so came in second last year, came out here to win it this year.
But not just any golf team was allowed to enter. They had to qualify at their local courses to play here. But once they did, they were treated to a great course.
The course is outstanding. It's well kept. It's a great competition here among all different commands. It's absolutely the best time.
You didn't need to be a professional to play on the Desert Strike. You could be a hacker like me. Even though the course was designed for all types of players, the best ball format allowed players to choose which ball they would play.
Well, it adds a little bit more excitement into it. You know, you're counting on your partner, not just yourself. You know, you got somebody to help you out there.
But even with the best ball format and a forgiving course, golfers were still having a tough time.
Get in there.
But there was a winner. And when the scores were tallied up, the team of the USS John Young shot a 10-under par 62 and defended their title. And for them, it was definitely a team effort.
Tremendous effort from everybody. All four members of the team participated. You know, everybody has individual talents that we do.
And we just wanted to play hole by hole and see how we did.
But golf wasn't the only thing participants did. They also helped raise money for the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society.
It's good. I've always donated to the Navy Relief every time I get a chance, once a year at least. You know, so it's a really good cause that we're doing here.
That makes me feel pretty good. I mean, they help people out. They've helped me out before, and I'm just glad they can give back.
When it was all said and done, the course at Indian Wells proved to be the perfect setting for this golf championship. Players played in the heat of the desert to help those who can sometimes be left out in the cold. From Indian Wells, California, Petty Officer Chris Robinson, Navy Marine Corps News.
a great day of golf, and they were able to help out the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society. Not bad for a day's work.
I'd say so. And up next, the Shipshape crew is going to put you to work.
This week, Clark Bartram and HM2 Jeff Bramstead teach us a very unique way to work your arms.
I'm Clark Bartram, and this is Shipshape.
I'm HM2 Jeff Bramstead, Navy SEAL.
You know, the Swiss ball is a relatively new piece of equipment in the health and fitness arena. But rehab specialists have been using it for years. And here to demonstrate for us today is Petty Officer Sean Turpey of Special Boat Unit 12.
You may be wondering how this can help you train. Well, guess what? There are over 270 different exercises that you can do with this piece of equipment.
Okay, now the purpose of the ball is to place your body in an unstable environment, thus taxing the muscles that stabilize your joints that you're using to do the exercise.
Let me show you. We'll start with a basic push-up. If your feet are placed up on a ball, like Sean's doing here, and your hands are on the ground, your body is in an unstable position. You'll be forcing your muscles to work in conjunction with your abdomen to keep your back stable.
Now the goal is to keep the ball still while you're doing your push-ups.
Now let's take that to the next level. If your feet are on a bench and your hands are on a ball, what do you think would happen? You're even more unstable. You're even using more muscles to maintain the stability of your body.
I guess that's the bottom line, because when you're using the ball, you'll have a better workout because you're using more muscle.
You can find a Swiss ball in almost any sporting goods store or any health and fitness store. And many base gyms are now getting them too.
You know, and more people are using this, I think, too.
That's right. We've been using it for over 2 years.
Well, that's all the time we have for now.
So remember, hard work now will pay off later, so stay focused.
And we'll see you next time on Shipshape.
That exercise is probably a lot tougher than it looks, even though they made it look easy.
You're right, and because it will take some time to learn how to use the Swiss ball, it would be a good idea to ask a shipmate to spot for you.
That's it for this week. Hope you enjoyed the show.
If you have any questions or comments about Navy Marine Corps news, email us at the address on the screen.
Or give us a call. Before we leave you this week, BZ to the Marines of Marine Corps Air Facilities Aircraft Rescue and Firefighting Team at Marine Corps Base Hawaii.
For the second year in a row, they've earned the Alan G. Ogden Award from the Navy Fire Protection Association.
Among the reasons the crew earned the award was because of its quality of training and its community work with local fire departments and other services.
Great job. We'd also like to say hi to our new viewers in Brockton, Massachusetts, who are watching us on the Brockton Community Access Channel.
We'll leave you this week with an awesome display of the Navy's carrier power.
Until next week,
take care.
Preparations for the storm started early, with Navy ships getting underway to avoid potential damage. The ships are much safer at sea than they would be pierside, where the combination of winds, high seas, and the piers themselves could cause damage and injuries. And while they were underway, sailors monitored the weather affecting their family members back home, with a special feed of local weather and news provided over the direct-to-sailor satellite network.
About Hurricane Floyd.
Hurricane Floyd is history, but he sure did make his mark on Hampton Roads.
Once ships get underway, their mission is simple: steer clear of the storm. But USS John F. Kennedy steered itself back into the storm to perform a daring rescue of tugboat sailors who were forced to abandon ship. The Navy's rescue efforts didn't end once the storm passed by. Sailors from Helicopter Combat Support Squadrons 2 and 6 teamed up to rescue hundreds of North Carolina residents from flooded areas in the days after the hurricane.
In the last 7 hours, we rescued 60 people to higher ground. Some were in the water, some were on dry land. It's another day in the office. That's a great feeling. The first one this morning was a couple stranded in a car in about 4 foot of water. And she had about a 10 or 11 month old baby, which is about the age of my son at home. And that was a great feeling.
These sailors rescued nearly 800 residents in four counties and provided food, drinking water, and medical supplies to the stricken area. Chief Tom Kreidel, Navy Marine Corps News.
Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Jay Johnson congratulated sailors on a job well done during recent operations while the Roosevelt Battle Group was on deployment.
It gave me an opportunity as TR steams through the Med toward home to thank them for the incredible deployment that they've had, both here in the Mediterranean, in the Adriatic with the operations in Kosovo, and in the Arabian Gulf with Operation Southern Watch. It's been a tremendously important deployment, executed beautifully, and I'm tremendously proud, and I wanted to convey that to these wonderful men and women.
Admiral Johnson also talked about pay issues while on board the TR, USS Ramage, and the Leyte Gulf.
Then on January 1st of 2000, you're going to get a 4.8% pay raise. But in addition to that, on July 1st of 2000, we're going to put into place something called pay table reform, which essentially is a matrix spread across all E1 to O10, okay, so that there are some people, mid-grade enlisted particularly and mid-grade officers, who are going to get in excess of that 4.8% pay raise.
The CNO also had good news for sailors who joined the Navy after August 1986.
All of you are going to have the option of stepping out of the redux retirement business, the 40% retirement. And you have the option of going to what everybody else has got that joined before or after 1980, what's called the high three retirement, and you can make that choice. Or you have the choice of taking $30,000 at the 15-year point in your career, committing to another 5 years of service, and then staying with redux. You have the choice.
In addition, Admiral Johnson took the time to talk with some sailors and even stop for a few photo opportunities.
People don't really thank us for our job, and for him to come out here and personally thank us is, I think, is a great thing for morale and for everybody on the ship.
It's nice to know that the higher-ups were listening and that they actually care.
I'm Petty Officer Chris Avant, Navy Marine Corps News.
...120 players, 31 commands, one golf course. Indian Wells recently played host to the 1999 Desert Strike Invitational Championship Golf Tournament, which involved the best military golf teams in Southern California, all gunning to be number one.
That's great. We played last year, so came in second last year, came out here to win it this year.
But not just any golf team was allowed to enter. They had to qualify at their local courses to play here. But once they did, they were treated to a great course.
The course is outstanding. It's well kept. It's a great competition here among all different commands. It's absolutely the best time.
You didn't need to be a professional to play on the Desert Strike. You could be a hacker, like me.
Even though the course was designed for all types of players, the best ball format allowed players to choose which ball they would play.
It adds a little bit more excitement into it. You know, you're counting on your partner, not just yourself. You know, you got somebody to help you out there.
But even with the best ball format and a forgiving course, golfers were still having a tough time.
Get in there, get in there.
But there was a winner. And when the scores were tallied up, the team of the USS John Young shot a 10-under par 62 and defended their title. And for them, it was definitely a team effort.
Tremendous effort from everybody. All four. members of the team participated. You know, everybody has individual talents that we do.
And we just wanted to play hole by hole and see how we did.
But golf wasn't the only thing participants did. They also helped raise money for the Navy Marine Corps Relief Society.
It's good. I've always donated to the Navy Relief every time I get a chance, once a year at least. You know, so it's a really good cause that we're doing here.
That makes me feel pretty good. I mean, they help people out. They've helped me out before. And I'm just glad they can give back.
When it was all said and done, the course at Indian Wells proved to be the perfect setting for this golf championship. Players played in the heat of the desert to help those who can sometimes be left out in the cold. From Indian Wells, California, Petty Officer Chris Robinson, Navy Marine Corps News.
Yes. The Naval Criminal Investigative Service organized the training to teach the organizations how to work well together and stay prepared.
Crystal Breakers is an exercise that tests our multi-service and multi-agency response to a chemical, biological, terrorist-type situation in this urban environment that we have in Washington.
The target this day was a room on the second floor of a barracks building. The scenario: three terrorists holding sailors and civilians hostage. The problem: how to free the hostages from obvious danger.
There's no need to get all excited. Everything is okay. We're not playing any tricks.
The negotiators denied the terrorists' demand for a face-to-face meeting with Secretary of the Navy Richard Danzig, but did shut off the building's fire alarm and provided food and an American flag.
Get on your hands and knees!
But in the end, the negotiations failed, and it was time to call in the SWAT team to storm the building. The terrorists were ready for them and set a few traps. Teamwork also played a vital role in apprehending the subjects. This exercise also tested the team's ability to deal with the risk of chemical and biological contamination. Local hospitals were also called upon to treat simulated injuries. Sailors who played the part of hostages were freed, but were happy to be out of the situation and thankful for the training.
It was kind of neat, but scary at the same time, because going through somewhat an actual thing, knowing that in actuality, if it really did happen, it'd be a lot worse than what we had gone through.
Petty Officer Nico Melendez, Navy Marine Corps News.
Hello, shipmates. MCPON Herdt here. PT has been a hot topic everywhere I visited this year. There is not a moratorium on PT. There is a moratorium, however, on administrative separations resulting from the PRT program. It was the right thing to do for 1 year for several reasons. As the new program comes online, the basic changes you can expect include that commands won't pay the price for sailors trying to eat their way out of the Navy. The PT test itself will require a little more from sailors in most areas, and there will be a more structured remedial program. There's no better way to lead sailors than from the front while conducting PT. Physical fitness needs to be a way of life for sailors. A better fit fleet is a win-win situation for everyone involved. Until the next time, I'll see you about the fleet.
MedCure 99, conducted by U.S. Naval Forces Europe, was a joint and combined training and medical exercise conducted to provide an interchange of medical information and techniques with military and civilian medical personnel from Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia.
The most aim of this exercise was to train our staff, it means the Lithuanian and Estonian, to the basics of international operations, procedures, the Geneva Convention, also that gives a good example of the international collaboration between the American medics and ours.
This gives us a chance to learn from each other, get to know each other, see how we each work, what we expect of each other, and to be fully prepared in any future type of peace support type of operations that might come up.
About 100 American military members and civilians joined another 100 doctors and medical specialists from the Baltic countries in the exercise. U.S. participants included Navy doctors, nurses, and corpsmen from U.S. and European commands, U.S. Air Force, and U.S. Army Europe. Also taking part were disaster management and humanitarian assistance specialists, as well as civilian medical personnel.
We've got to be able to work as a team. If we go to a crisis or some sort of catastrophe,
if we can't work together with other people, it's not going to get accomplished. And this is the way to do it. I mean, we know, they know how our triage is, and we're all on the same sheet of music, and we're working together.
MedCure was conducted in two phases. The first was classroom training, which covered emergency medical procedures, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, and preventive medicine. The second phase was the practical application of the classroom lessons, culminating with a simulated airplane crash. The drill included medical problems common to disasters, such as triage, field anesthesia, and shock. Exercises such as MedCure 99 allow nations to practice these skills before they are needed. They promote a valuable familiarity with the operating environment of the Baltic region. After all, a crisis is not the time to learn how to work with another nation.
There's no doubt that every Marine has felt like somebody's workhorse at one time or another, but for Marines with 1st Battalion, 7th Marine Regiment, they recently got a break.
When they told me I was going to be a mule packer, I figured they were talking about me packing more stuff, but I didn't know they actually had animals, so it was a pleasant surprise.
Not only were they surprised to find out they weren't going to carry their weapons to the field, but that the Marine Corps' very own mules were going to carry them.
Yeah, you can get mules probably more places than you can get like a Hummer, but I'd rather put my 50 cal on a mule than have it on my shoulders.
Six mules and two horses are year-round residents at the Marine Corps' only pack station. Infantry battalions, weapons platoons in particular, rely on mule packing training to show how animals can be used when mechanized vehicles are not available.
You know, for like a one-day movement, a fairly short movement, like we're going on today, 6, 7, 8 miles, you know, you could put up to probably 300 pounds on them. You know, and it's not so much as the number of packs they can carry, but it's how much packs weigh and how much whatever you're putting on there weighs. Usually we try to put, what we teach these guys is like a quarter of their estimated weight.
Mules are a crossbreed of horse and donkey and have proved to be the ideal animal to carry gear, food, and water. Reporting for Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Sergeant Amy Forsyth.
Six sailors from USS Eisenhower and USS San Jacinto traded their Navy ball caps for NASCAR ball caps at a day at the races. But these sailors weren't just spectators at the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race. They served as honorary crew members.
That's outstanding. I mean, the treatment that we're getting here is just the top of the line. This is totally too much.
The crew exchange was NASCAR's way of thanking the two ships' crews for hosting six of the race truck drivers in July. The drivers toured the San Jacinto port and flew out to the Ike for 2 days of shipboard life.
Well, I mean, you know, you guys took care of us, and it was quite the trip that we went on and had quite an adventure. So to come back and have you guys see our side of the world is something that we thought we should do.
We got a chance to see what all they do out there, and it's something spectacular. So. It's a good thing that they get to come and visit with us.
When the sailors arrived at the racetrack, they were paired off with six different drivers. They spent the rest of the day lending a helping hand in the garage and asking lots of questions.
My goal was to become a Winston Cup mechanic or a truck mechanic, one of the two. And when I heard about this, I knew it was an opportunity of a lifetime for me.
Once the race started, the crew chiefs wasted no time putting them to work. Watching the real pit crews change four tires, tighten bolts and fill gas tanks was a great lesson in teamwork for these sailors.
Well, I think it's more important here because these mechanics are reading each other's minds, and it's just, things are just coming natural for them.
While each sailor rooted for his own team during the 200-mile race, they all helped Greg Biffle celebrate in the winner's circle. From Richmond International Raceway, I'm Petty Officer Kathy Thomas, Navy Marine Corps News.
I'm Clark Bartram, and this is Shipshape.
I'm HM2 Jeff Branford, the Navy SEAL.
You know, the Swiss ball is a relatively new piece of equipment in the health and fitness arena. But rehab specialists have been using it for years. And here to demonstrate for us today is Petty Officer Sean Turpey of Special Boat Unit 12.
You may be wondering how this can help you train. Well, guess what? There are over 270 different exercises that you can do with this piece of equipment.
Okay, now the purpose of the ball is to place your body in an unstable environment, thus taxing the muscles that stabilize your joints that you're using to do the exercise.
Let me show you. We'll start with a basic push-up. If your feet are placed up on a ball, like Sean's doing here, and your hands are on the ground, your body is in an unstable position. You'll be forcing your muscles to work in conjunction with your abdomen to keep your back stable.
Now the goal is to keep the ball still while you're doing your push-ups.
Now let's take that to the next level. If your feet are on a bench and your hands are on a ball, what do you think would happen? You're even more unstable. You're even using more muscles to maintain the stability of your body.
I guess that's the bottom line, because when you're using the ball, you'll have a better workout because you're using more muscle.
You can find a Swiss ball in almost any sporting goods store or any health and fitness store. And many base gyms are now getting them too.
You know, and more people are using this, I think, too.
That's right. We've been using it for over 2 years.
Well, that's all the time we have for now.
So remember, hard work now will pay off later, so stay focused.
And we'll see you next time on Ship Shape.